Good morning all. Today we are going to see in the software testing 4th unit, the testing services, test planning and test plan components, which have been shown in blue color. So these are the three topics we are going to see today. First topic is testing services organization. So in testing services organization, what they will do, they will just outsource the testing activities to external companies who have been specialized in testing, and they will provide the testing services to us. So this is the concept we are going to see in testing services organization. So first of all, first topic is, what is the business need for testing services? So some of the business drivers as a service are, first of all, they will see as a see the testing as a specialized function. This specialized function, how we can attain is through the testing services organization, they will fulfill their needs. Next is product development organization. In product development organization, we can have some of the expertise who are very well understood the domain of the software, but they will not know how to run or set up the environment to follow the same. That is the thing. And in fourth one is the, they can offer the, that is outsourcing testing services organization, they can offer the location advantages, that is they will always work around the clock coverage, and also they will provide the cost advantages, that is overall cost also can be reduced. So this is the business need for testing services. The next one, we are going to see the differences between the testing as a service and the product in the testing organizations. First difference is, testing services organizations are held at arm's length from product developers. That is, whenever the product development companies, they can have the testing team internal to the organization, they can have a closer binding between the developers and the testers. But when we consider the outsourcing the testing services to the other organization, then they will not have a good rapport between the product developers and the testers who are testing the outsourcing companies. Next difference is, testing service organization may not provide full breadth of coverage. That is, what they will do only small kind of testing like black box testing or the domain testing or the specialized testing like performance testing. But when we consider the white box testing, that they will not definitely do. Then next difference is, testing service organization tend to be more homogeneous. That is, whenever we are considering in the product organization, we can have many job titles, like we can have many teams, that is development team, maintenance team, support team, and the testing team. But when we consider the testing service organization, we have only option as testing team. They will have the job title and the job definitions also, it will be homogeneous, that is, it will be the same kind of a thing. So these are the differences between the testing as a service and the product. How the testing it will be done in the product companies, and the how the testing it will be done from the outside service companies. Next one, we are going to see the roles and responsibilities of testing service organizations. So here the testing service organization, they will have the number of accounts. According to the some of the customers allocated, each account will be having an account manager who will be the single point of contact from the customer side as well also from the testing service organization. Here the account manager, they will do the following functions. They will develop the rapport between the customer, and they are responsible for ensuring whether the current project has been delivered accordingly, and also they will take up the new projects. And here they will participate in all the communication between the customer and the testing service organization. And also they will act as a proxy. Proxy means that authority they can have for the customer within the testing service organization. So these are the functions that account manager can do. Next one, in the testing service team organization, they itself, they will divide the team into two parts. One is near site team, next one is remote site team. So we'll see the first near site team, what they will do. Near site team is a small team. They'll be placed near the customer location. And then whatever functions they are being responsible with, they'll be the first point of contact for the customer point of view. And also in case of emergencies, whenever remote team is not available, they will act as the stopgap. And also say third one is, they build a good rapport between the customer team and the testing. The fixed manners remote team. Remote team is located on the site of the testing services organization. Usually they will be large in number. Due to large in number, one manager will be there who is going to take the control of the entire remote team and have the peer-to-peer relationship with the near-site team. And whoever is there in the near-site team who is going to report to him also will be there. And next one is remote teams and the near-site team, they will be usually rotated around. Some of the remote teams can also coach it as a some of the question in the near-site team. So we'll see the pictorial representation of whatever I have told now. That is the near side team and the remote side team. First of all, in the left side, that is the customer side, we can have customer contact. And then in the testing services organization, account manager will be there who is going to be point of contact between the near side team and the remote side team. In remote side team, we can have remote team manager. Under that, we can have test leads. Then test leads who will be leading the test engineers. In account manager also, who is going to responsible and who is going to report to the CEO or the VP. So that's all about your typical roles and responsibilities of testing services organization. Now we are going to see the challenges and the issues in testing services organization. We'll see one by one. First one is outsider effect and the estimation of resources. That is, whenever outside person comes into the development organization, what on the implications will be there? Actually, they will not have the necessary access to the product code as when we compare to the internal product testing team. And also, they will not have the access to the history of the product. And also, they will not have enough information to plan the testing and prioritize the test cases. And the third one is, we will not have enough good rapport between the development teams as when we compare to the internal product testing team. And one more thing is, we can have the hardware and the software information to be shared between the testing organization, that is outsider, and the development team. But this is not the case whenever we can have the internal testing team with the product developers. So these are the implications. Next one is domain expertise. That is, in the internal testing team in the product organization, they can have the domain expertise who is expertise in the particular domain. For example, when we consider the ERP software organization, they can have the some of the specialized person who is expertise in ERP domain. But when we consider the testing or service organization, they cannot have the domain expertise for the multiple customers because they are going to support the multiple customers. Next one is privacy and the customer allocation issues. That is, testing service organization, they can have the common infrastructure. From that, different teams will be allocated. So isolation of this different team may be difficult. That is, whenever people working in one project, they move to the another project, what happens here, this movement should be full of confidence, and also we need to maintain the transparency. That is, whatever you have learned in the customer point of view, we should not take into the other project. That is the customer isolation issues. Next one is apportioning hardware and the software resources and the cost. So whenever the testing services organization, we are going to work with the multiple customer, definitely some of the common resources they will be using, hardware or the software. But we need to apportion it, that is, we need to divide it and share it, the cost associated with these resources across the different project while we are going for the cost in the project. Next one is maintaining a bench. So maintaining the benches, testing service organization always should be ready with the people whoever is going to deploy next, because customer suddenly comes with a new project. So in that time, we cannot go and search some of the people in the outside. So we need to make sure whether the people are ready to be deployed. In some cases also, we can have the customer to look into the resumes of these specific individuals and have a handpicking people from the service organization to take part in the testing project. So these are the challenges and the issues in the testing services organizations. So next topic is testing and debugging goals and the policies. So introduction, let us here we can have two maturity goals at the level 2 of PMO. PMO is testing maturity model. So what are the goals are there? First goal is developing organizational goals or the policies to the testing and the debugging. And second one is test planning. Here they are considered as a testing is a managed process that should be managed and should also be repeatable. Okay. So first we'll see the organization goals and the policies related to testing and as well as the debugging. So here, before going to see about the debugging and testing, we should want to ensure whether we are understand some of the goals. Here we have some of the types of the goals. First goal is business goal. Second goal is technical goal. And then third one is business or technical goal. And then fourth one, political goal. In business goal, they will just see how the market share is being increased by what percentage in the next 2 or 3 years. And then technical goal is we just want to reduce the defect by some amount of percentage in the next 2 to 3 years. And then business or the technical goal combined means we need to reduce the support calls, whatever comes after delivery of the project, by a certain percentage over the next 2 to 3 years. And what about the political goal? We need to increase the number of management position by a certain percentage in the next 2 to 3 years. So these are the types of goals we can have. Next one is testing and debugging goals and the policies, whatever we can have in the organization. So first of all, I just define the goals. What is a goal? It is a statement of intent. Intent means it is a purpose. Then for what purpose we are going to work? Some goal should be there, right? That is the statement of an accomplishment, or we can say achievement, that an individual or an organization wants to achieve. Here there are 3 levels are there. At the top level is the organization goal. At the intermediate level goals, we can have the organization goals in the terms of functional unit. In the personal level goals, we can have the self-improvement of the individual. Whoever takes part in the project should contribute to the project as well as to the organization as well as to the functional unit. And each individual project also should have a specific goals. These will be reflecting in the organization goals. Next, we can have some of the statements, how the goal should be. Okay, how it should be, it can be expressed either in the terms of quantitative measures or in the terms of the gender terms. That is, quantitative measures means in the measurement, some form of a measurement. First one is 100% of testing activities are planned. That is, some of the percentage is being given. Next one, degree of automation for the regression testing is being increased from certain percentage to certain percentage over the next 2 to 3 years. So this is the quantitative measure they have mentioned in the goal statement. First two are the quantitative terms, and the third and fourth are the gender terms. Third and fourth, what it means testing activity should be performed by a separate testing group. And also testing group members, what they have to attain, they at least should have a bachelor degree, and also they should complete a course of a software testing. So these are the goal statement in general terms. Next one is, before going into the testing and debugging process, we just see the policy. What is called as a policy? It is a statement, high level statement of principle or a course of action to be taken place in the organization. So what is the principle we need to follow to perform a set of activities in an organization? That is called as a policy. Policy provides the framework for the decision making. So this provides a kind of a framework for decision making. And also in testing policy statement, it is used to guide for testing purpose also. We can have a testing policy statement. For what purpose that policy statement is being used? It is used to guide the test. This is the testing activities we need to deploy it, and this is the process we need to follow. So that is the testing policy statement. Next one, we can have 2 types. One is testing policy. Next one is debugging policy in organization X. So there are some of the policy statements are there. First one is, we need to deliver the software so that is of the highest quality. That is the company goal. Okay. So that means we should not hide any of the defects. That if the defects are revealed, means we should detect it and we should correct it before going into the customer side, because defects will have a negative impact to the organization. Next one is, we need to follow some of the testing standards. So that standards, it will be available in the intra-organizational website. So that standard, what is the standard denote? It is going to denote all the test-related documents and the test kind of activities. And third one is, in our organization, the following things need to be applied for the software development or the maintenance project. First of all, we need to consider the execution-based testing. And then second one is systematic approaches. Execution-based testing should be applied to all the levels of this unit, system, integration, and the acceptance. And the systematic approaches to be black box testing and the white box testing, and review should be made to all the documents, that is design document, requirement document, testing document, and coding document, everything. And next one is, testing must be planned for all the projects, and testing activities also we need to capture it using some kind of measurements, and the defects should be classified and also be recorded. And there should be a training program in order to ensure whether the testing staff gets enough training to use the testing tools. And fourth one is, testing is an activity that should be performed by an independent testing group. And fifth one is, it should be supported by the tools and also some kind of measurements. And then sixth one is, appropriate resources should be provided in order to do testing. And seventh one is, to our clients or the developer or the tester, communication is very important. They should have the enough communication line in order to perform testing. And the last one is, to manage all these testing policy, one person should be there, that is managerial staff, and the technical staff should be appointed in the part of organization in order to maintain all these testing policies. So these are the 8 policy statements in an organization. Next one is debugging policy. We'll see debugging policy in an organization EX. What are the policy statements are there? First of all, they'll consider the testing and the debugging process as a separate process, because testing is a process in order to ensure whether the product is running correctly without any defects. But debugging is the process in order to make the defects to be located, repair the code, and retesting the code. So these are the things it will be there in the debugging process. And second point is, debugging is a timely activity. It will take some time. That time should be allowed for to make enough number of repairs. And then third one is, debugging tools. So what is the debugging tool we are going to do? That training should be given to the developers to use the tools. And then fourth one is, developers or the testers and also the SQA staff, they should define and document the some of the defect classes and the severity levels, because after finding the defects, they need to capture it in the defect classes and also the severity. For that purpose, they need to define and document these defect classes. And then fifth one is, the problem or the test incident report should be completed. So always after detecting a defect, we need to complete one of the report, that is called as a test incident report. It should be done by the developer or the tester at the testing time, then it will be useful for the project history. And then sixth one is, all the defects should be identified. Whatever defects have been identified, it should be captured in the corresponding defect classes and also the severity level. Then it should be stored as a part of project history. And then seventh one is, how we can measure the testing. By the total number of defects or the total number of defects in KLOC. KLOC is kilo lines of code, that is 1,000 lines of codes. And then what is the time required to repair the defects? And then last one is, as I said in the testing policy, similarly, we can also have the managerial and technical staff should be appointed to manage all these debugging policy. So that's all about the debugging policy. So once I'll summarize the things what we have learned. First of all, we saw about the testing services in an organization and the business needs and the differences between the testing as a service and the testing in the product companies. And then second, third one is challenges and issues in the testing services organization. Then we saw about the introduction about the testing and debugging goals and the policies. What is the goal? What is the goal statement? Then types of goals. Then testing policy. How? What are the policy statements we are going to follow for the organization? Then what are the policy statements we are going to follow for the debugging policy in an organization? So these are the things we saw in this session. So in next section, a separate video has been uploaded for the test planning and the test plan components. Thank you.